Sign sheets going around. I think it's over here somewhere, is that right? So please kind of for you. I had a question, but I've been taking time to meet you to go over any quiz questions. Yes, how many, can I get a show of hands? How many people want to talk to me on quiz?
All right.
So right now, I'm only going to be 5-10 minutes back, and that's about it, unless I've been for 15 minutes. All right, today's finish up lecture 15. Any remaining tests that were not coming are in the back. So if you have a friend who let you pick up the test, if he's not here, please probably have a phone to their permission. Otherwise, if you didn't get the test, please check in the back table today. So today we'll take a look at lecture 14. Yes, I will be testing more exam 3, week 1, definitely with me and the teacher you plan to cover tomorrow. I have talked to John, as you read that you have a test coming up on the 15th, and that he should be holding some of his health test. I don't know when he's going to do that, but he's talking about that today. I would definitely get your homework up to date before next Wednesday. Particularly for those chapters or sections on the upcoming test, make sure you wait for them.
We have to draw.
Okay. Yep. Not drawing.
Maxwell diagrams just take that, you know, they're complicated for that reason, difficult to do in a test time frame. So there might be questions on them, but you won't be drawing them. Okay, so there's two examples here of how you can calculate and arrive at some of the stress and load conditions on a folded plate. So we'll do one that's going to be steel and one that will be concrete, cast in place concrete. And then we sort of be finishing up on that. We'll be moving to the next system, which is similar to a folded plate, is a two-way acting system, but it has a secondary and primary span. Those are cylindrical vaults. They have generally somewhat similar profiles and characteristics, but we're moving, what I'm getting at is we move into cylindrical vaults, then there's gonna be a group of about 4 lectures that are now starting to deal with curvature surfaces. And so the linear frames we've spent our time with up to now, we're gonna be kind of ending that. You're gonna be looking at curvilinear surfaces. And so some of the calculations are all gonna be driven by the nature of finding things like forces and areas and stress conditions that come from these curvilinear surfaces and these shapes. And they're again going to be long span. So here's our span at 90 feet. That's the principal span. You see it on the bottom right-hand side. It's got a total height of 9 feet. That's from the bottom to the vertice at the top. The full width between supports on the ends is 25 feet. There are four columns on each one of the folds. They do have a continuity so that one fold is linking to the other fold, as you can see here in the diagram. Snow roof live load is 25 PSF, dead load is 16. It's a steel system. The weight of one plate, the dead load steel decking, corrugated metal decking is 5 PSF. There's a membrane for the roof and insulation on top that's 5 PSF. And then there's a truss frame. So if you see the blue lines on the lower right-hand side, all intents and purposes, that's kind of like the master truss framework, if you will. I know I don't show diagonals in there, but that's the element that's predominantly forming the primary span conditions for it. And we have a bending stress of 22 KSI as our limit. So the first check is some to do with geometry and behavior. So we're taking a look at height to length, 9/90, 1:10. That's okay. A 1:10 height to depth ratio would be sufficient to give adequate depth for bending forces relative to span. The system geometry, if it's 25 feet from the support points on either side of the base, then from the point to the top or the apex would be half of that. So that'd be 12.5 feet or half of 25. The actual fold angle is the arc 10 of 9/12.5. That gives us 35.75 degrees. And we'll need cosine and sine, so I'm just going to calculate them right now. Cosine of the angle phi is 8.812, and sine is 0.584. And our system force distribution, the incline width of a typical plate, lowercase b, that's the slope dimension, would be 12.5 divided by cosine phi, or 15.4 feet. We need to do that because we need to do some load translations, meaning dead loads and live loads are not assumed to be in the same span condition. The span to width ratio of a plate would be L over B, lowercase b, 90 divided by 15.4. We're looking for any number more than 2. If the number is larger than 2, we know we have a long span principal span condition and a short span transverse. In other words, we have one-way action. If it was more like 2:2, we almost have like a two-way acting system. We don't really have a principal span. So it's just a shape. These are largely shape and geometry configuration issues that we need to know. Our total load check to get started, dead load plus live loads, 10 PSF. And I want you to notice what's going on here. We're dividing that by the cosine 0.812. And then we're adding that 25 PSF. And why are we doing that? Because the actual live load or dead load is following the 15.4 foot dimension. That's the self weight. But our live load is always perpendicular to ground. Now, you might remember the same conversation with arches, right? We had that similar conversation with arches. So the point is, when you divide that value of 10 PSF by the cosine, now you have the equivalent horizontal span condition load. So it's no longer saying the span is 15.4 feet for dead load, but I'm going to put it back on 12.5 feet, which is the span for the live load condition. It's always perpendicular to ground. So we get a bump up there. The 10 gets bumped up. And you can see that because you would have been 35 PSF if it wasn't increased, but it's larger than that. It's the 37.32. So the math check is, if you did this correctly, the number obviously should show an increase in the total load from the dead load. So you'll have a bending check. The maximum moment at midspan is the panel's treated as simply supported uniformly loaded beam. It would be M1 or 1/8 WL squared WL capital B squared plus 1/8 B capital B squared. And at this point, we're using capital B because now we've already translated our dead load accordingly. So 1/8 25 PSF times 12.5 squared plus the 1/8 times 12.32, now translated to 12.5 for span condition. So therefore, our span is 12.5 squared. We get 728.81 pound feet. What section modulus does this need to have to resist bending? We need to hit a value in inches cubed based on maximum moment divided by FB. Capital FB is the allowable bending stress in PSI. We already know what it is. We said it was 22 KSI or 22,000 PSI. So the 70, 721.8, remember that's in pound feet, needs to be converted to inches. So we do the inch conversion. We need 0.398 inches cubed per 1 foot wide segment of this inclined plate. Now remember, we're measuring it in the short axis, okay? And that's the corrugated metal decking. So we did what's called the unit strip method. We took a 1 foot wide slice of it, and that's how we're evaluating it. Just like when you did a concrete slab, maybe in intermediate structures, you take a 1 foot wide slice, same thing here. So checking to see what's available for you if you're gonna use a corrugated metal decking to span that condition and support that load. So I looked it up. If we had a 0.168 inch gauge, that's 1 inches in thickness for the corrugated metal decking, we would find an S value in inches cubed. That's data that's published on these products, a 0.517. And I'm looking for a value basically a little bit larger than 0.4. And that's the best I could do. So I know I have some reserve capacity and it's okay. Now, the next question is, how does it behave in the long axis? That's the 90 foot span condition. Well, kind of think about that big plate as like a beam that's sort of like been tipped on its side, but it's basically acting as a uniformly loaded, simply supported beam at 90 feet. So we have 16 PSF. Now, what changed here? Well, in the first load condition, transverse, the weight of the truss frame was not considered because the work is being done by the corrugated metal decking in the short axis. So the extra 6 PSF is that weight of that truss frame. That was the blue lines that I showed you earlier. So that has to get added back. So that's why it's different. And our weight in W and pounds per feet, doing our numbers. And now I did kind of fool around a little bit with it just so I could show you how to do this another way. I did put lowercase b back in dead load. And I'm going to the 16 PSF times the 15.4. So it's a variant form of what I did earlier, but it's okay, you can do it that way. And I get the 558.9 PLF. Now, remember we said that there's sort of two different loads coming down on these on this system. One of them is perpendicular to the plate. The other one would be parallel to the plate. So our W prime value that we are using is W divided by sine phi, have 558.9 divided by 0.584. So we get 957 pounds per linear feet. Our maximum moment converting the kips, 1/8 times W. And kips times the 90 feet squared gives me 968 foot kips, roughly 969 foot kips. Now, what is going to resist that in the system? Well, at the very top or the apex, we would have what we would sort of refer to as a flange at the top or an element at the top. And then at the very bottom in the V shape, there's another element down there. So those are like top and bottom cords of a truss. And that's what's going to do the work for bending. So the initial calculation is to say how much area is needed for these two, for these flange elements, top and bottom. And the AF is shown here as in inches squared as M2 divided by lowercase b times 1 over FA. FA is axial stress allowed in compression or tension. And the reason I'm not trying to find the slenderness ratio, I'll allude to that in a moment, is because there is continuous bracing of that top and bottom element with the corrugated metal decking. Let's say it's welded at some increment, very small increment, so it's stabilizing it from buckling. So my AF turns out to be 2.86 inches squared. But because you have two panels coming together at the top and two panels coming together at the bottom, you multiply that value by 2 because each vertice point, top or bottom, has got to pick up two panel loads. So we get an area now 5.72 inches squared. If you chose a WT8 by 20, that's a potential shape that might make sense. You'd wind up with 5.89 inches squared. That's a possibility for this. You need any value larger than 5.72. F sub A, as I said, I didn't check that because I don't need to. The decking is providing stiffness so that we don't have a buckling issue in compression side. The shear evaluation would occur at the web points, and the largest shear point is going to be the reactions. All the loads for shear magnitude increase at the reaction point. So my shear value in pounds is 2W prime times L over 2. Plugging in my values, I get 86,000 pounds roughly. And what's the shear in per linear feet? Well, per linear feet, the unit shear going through this would be the 86,131. But remember, the actual panel length at that point is 15.4 feet. So the unit shear in pounds per linear feet it's kind of like, think about it like a shear wall. Remember we talked about shear diaphragms and shear walls, forces and shear. It's sort of the same thing. You get 55,092 PLF. Now, the welding of the decking has to be sufficient to carry the shear load. This is a high value. So if I looked at systems like this and I saw what their shear capacity was, unfortunately, I'm going to find that they top out at about 2,900 PLF. That's with the best and most intense level of weld point connections to stiffen it. It won't get any better than that. So at this point, the only alternative I'd have is to find another way to take the shear. So if we go back to that drawing, imagine I'm going to have to wind up putting essentially like diagonal elements in here, particularly needed at the endpoints. And the diagonal element will be picking up my shear. And that would be the potential solution then to solve that dilemma. Deflection. We talked about deflection earlier. It's a flexural characteristic, but also a shear characteristic in this case based on span and the behavior of the system. And our moment of inertia maximum for one of these plates would be the 2 AFB/2². Units are in inches. So notice we do have to convert the 15.4 feet for lowercase b, and we wind up with 48,000 inches to the fourth. Now that seems like a really large number compared to any I value you might have checked before for structural elements in, let's say, intermediate structures. But remember, this is like 15 feet deep beam. So it's extremely large, in other words. Deflection due to bending, 5/384, that's our deflection limit for uniformly loaded, simply supported members, times due to 2W(L)³/3EI, and times 12 inches for unit consistency. My bending contribution to deflection is 2 inches. Just breaking down all the math. Units are all consistent. What's my total allowable deflection? Well, it's a roof, so it's L/240. Floors would be L/360. So we have 90 feet times 12 inches divided by 240. It can take 4.5 inches. I've only used up 2, correct? So what do I have left? I have 2.5 left, right? So down here, you're getting to the point. This is my shear deflection. This is the deflection attributed to shear, which I know we've probably never talked about before in a member, but it does apply to these because of their dimensions, their load conditions, and their geometries. We have delta bending. That's our 2 inches. We have delta shear, and we've got a total of delta T. So breaking that down, this value of 2 inches plus whatever I compute here can't be more than 4.5 inches. Now, the problem with this is you're solving for G prime. It's not a value that you're going to find. It's a value that you would have to derive, and then you'd have to find the configuration instruction, construction system elements that you would need to create that limit. So boiling down the math here, plugging in our appropriate values, unit consistency all the way through, we wind up with 3.54 inches here. And converting that back now, solving for G, I have G that's needed. This is, you would say, is the shear stiffness capability of the system. It has to be 50,000 pounds per inch per 1 foot width. All right, now let's suppose it's made up of cast in place concrete. Where do we go from there? Same formulas all over again, but then they're just derived differently. They have different characteristics for the systems and the values. A reinforcing steel for these is usually small because you don't like very thick panels. You know, you want to keep them, you know, if you can, 3 inches or 4 inches, not more than that. Code limit says they can't be less than 3 inches in thickness. The ACI code would say you can't. And the reason is because steel basically subjected to reinforcing steel subjected to corrosion, and you need to have a minimum of 1 inch cover over the bars to prevent corrosion, water infiltration. So by default, you're already at 2 inches and you still have to have the bar in there. So 3 inches basically says, okay, let's assume that there's a fairly large bar in there, maybe 1 inch in diameter, largest value. The code will not allow you to make anything less than 3 inches in thickness. So our panel thickness T is greater than L/36 is a recommended starting point, but must be larger than 3 inches. L is my span in feet and T is my panel thickness in inches. Now here's the other characteristic that changes. It's a continuous cast in place pour for those folded plates. That means that the vertices at the top and the sort of the at the ridge, if you will, and then the bottom, the valley point, they're actually rigidly connected. They're not pin connected like they were in steel. So maximum moment is slightly off. It's capital W times B divided by 11. The mid-span moment would be capital WB divided by 16. Since the larger value governs WB over 11, notice it's negative because it's a negative moment will govern. In steel, we said WL over 12, right? It's more slightly more flexible than steel. Therefore, the moment value goes up a bit. So here's a concrete folded plate we reframe. Spans 90 feet again. Height's 8 feet. Full width is 2B, 24 feet. Load roof is the live load is 25 PSF again, but I've got to calculate the dead load because I don't know how thick the panel is of concrete, so I've got to arrive at that. So that's 5 PSF. That's the let's say the roofing membrane insulation. Not much there, and then I've got to figure out the self weight of the slab itself. We're going to use the ACI strength method and unit strip method again. We're going to slice a one foot wide slice of it. And the transverse or the short axis. The weight of one plate would be 150 pounds per cubic feet times 3 divided by 12 inches. That would give me my weight in PLF. My FY, my steel member strength is 60 KSI. The concrete strength and compression is 5 KSI. Again, B is one half of, uppercase B is one half of 24 or 12. Lowercase b, I did the math there for you. The angle is the 33 degrees. Would be 14.42 feet. Principal spans 90. And my system geometry, again, just validates my angle of inclination from the horizontal. And I need my sine and cosine again, so I'll pick those two values up. I'm going to do the same geometry check, span to height. Okay, roughly better, a little bit better than 1 to 10. Approximate thickness check is needed, though, because it's concrete. So B over 36 is equal to 12 feet times 12 inches divided by 36. It needs to be at least 4 inches. And since I'm up against a minimum of 3 inches, 4 inches works. So my system force distribution in the short axis, that's the, you know, the one half from the apex to the vertice. Lowercase b again was the 14.42. The span to width ratio of the plate, capital L over b is 6.24. Again, I want any value larger than 2 to make sure it moves in two directions or it is a one-way acting system in the long span. The bending check, cosine phi is 0.832, used for load conversion to the horizontal plane. The self-weight of the unit strip, a 1 foot wide slice, 4 inches times 150 pounds per cubic feet times 1 foot, because that's a 1 foot wide slice we're investigating from the apex to the bottom. Or 50 PLF plus 5 PSF, that was the other weights associated with the roof, membrane, insulation, et cetera. And it's again times 1 foot, because it's the unit strip, we get 55 PLF. The live load's 25 PSF times again 1 foot, or 25 PLF. The transverse panel, that's from the apex to the ridge, 1 foot wide slice again. Maximum moment, plugging in your values, and notice I use the negative 1/11. Plugging in all my values here for live load and dead load. But notice because it's concrete, there are two load modifiers. 1.7 going to my live load and 1.4 for my dead load. So I wind up with 1,767 pound feet. The transverse panel midspan moment. I don't know why I did this. I don't really need to, but I showed the 1/16th value. It's 1,215, but it's positive. Obviously, magnitude matters, so the negative 1767 would govern. All right, what's my maximum reinforcement ratio? Why do I have maximum minimum reinforcement ratios? Anybody know why? Anybody remember from intermediate structures? Everybody agrees that a cast-in-place concrete with steel and concrete together is a composite system, right? You have two different materials in there, right? So you've got the steel rods picking up tension, you've got the concrete picking up compression. Why do I need to have a reinforcement ratio limit? Why do I need to moderate that? Anybody know why? Which is stronger, steel or concrete? Modulus elasticity of steel is much stronger, right? obviously you don't need that much steel in the cross section because it's a lot stiffer, if you will, than the concrete. But why would I want to moderate? Why do I need to come to a ratio determination, balance it out? Well, the argument is you don't want the steel to fail first. You don't want the concrete to fail first. If you balance out the ratio of the two contributing to the strength of the system, both are equal fail points. Does that make sense? You want just enough steel, so it's essentially not undersized, so it's going to go. You don't want too much steel, so you're forcing the concrete to go. You want to keep it balanced, right? Also, for efficiency, why would you have more strength than you need? Does that make sense? Steel is going to be the cost, right? Putting more reinforcing bars, that's going to level up your cost. So they balance it out. All right, so we need 0.75 times rho, or 0.75 times 0.0335, or 0.251. You generally assume a maximum reinforcement condition for flexure in a slab is generally indicates the economical or most least depth slab. The thinnest slab means you use less concrete. My flexure check for these, d squared, the depth of the slab, is m sub u, ultimate moment, divided by 0.9, a safety factor, rho FYD times, this is a standard series here of values. These are constants, they're not variables. 1 minus 0.59 rho, and the ratio of the strength of the steel divided by the strength of the concrete. Plugging down all these values, and you divide it down, and you get d at 1.26 inches across the top. That isn't going to make it, right? I need to have at least 3 inches, right? So what is this starting to tell you? Well, let me give you an example. Felix Candela, famous sort of engineer, also sort of an architect from Spain, went down to Mexico and he was trying to build shells down there, and they had no code limit like the ACI of 3 inches, minimum thickness. And he was able to build shells like 7/8 of an inch or 1 inch, right? So he came to the United States and the code said, well, you have to have a 3-inch shell. And he just kind of backed off and said, no, thank you. I think I'll continue to build in Mexico, because his argument was, I don't need 3 inches. If I want to have an efficient system, I've proven that it works in Mexico, right? So my point is, you're going to have to bulk up and go to 3 inches, which generally kind of means you've got more strength there than you need. So what could you do? Well, you could back off on your compression stress allowed in the concrete. You know, maybe you don't go to 5,000. You might back off on that. That might be another way to do it. So we know that we need to have at least 4 inches. We've got 3 inches minimum plus one inch for the diameter, presumed diameter of the reinforcing steel. So we're up to about 4 inches. So the initial depth of our stress box A could be about 3 inch, 1 inch for our initial calculation. So what is that stress block? If you look on the right-hand side, the characteristics for bending stress in a concrete system, because it's a composite system, it has concrete and steel, is not the usual triangular shape, right? Remember that when you had any like wood or timber, you had the constant slope triangle, you went to zero at the neutral axis. It's not that. So it's a generalization of the parabolic curve that represents compression on the top side. It's just generalized to be a rectangle. It's just easier to calculate dimensions and values. So we solve for the area of the steel at the ends of the top of the slab, and we get As is m sub u divided by 0.9 Fy times d minus a over 2. Running our numbers, we get the amount of steel to be 0.16 inches squared. Checking again for the actual a value, and b is a 12-inch-foot-wide unit strip. We'll run our numbers a second time. We get to 0.188, solving for As actual. We do it the last time. Now that we have the actual bar stress, when we've got our actual values in place here, we get 0.13 inches squared per foot of slab length. If we find out what does that mean in terms of selecting a steel bar, the smallest steel bar you're going to get is the number 3. That's what I said you normally start with. That has a 0.11 inches squared for one bar. So if we space them at roughly 1.2 bars per foot, a number 3 bar at about 10 inches would be enough to provide the steel requirement of 1.135 inches squared for the slab. How would the reinforcing steel look? It might be something like this. It might go to the bottom side of the slab. I know it's supposed to be at an angle, but I didn't draw it that way because that's going to be the tension side, but then it might move upward to the top where, because it's a negative moment at the valley and the ridge at the top, you're going to see the steel needed at the top and not the bottom. So it may look something like that. Our minimum temperature reinforcement is 0.09 inches squared per foot. We're already above that. Checking for shear strength at the endpoints of the large folded plates. We've got our shear capacity here, 1.4 times 55 PLF divided by 0.832. We've got 810.24 pounds for our shear. The nominal shear strength of the slab, V sub N, rho, V times V sub C, we plug in our values, we get 5,000 pounds of shear capacity at the ends. So we really have a lot of safety in shear. We don't really need to be considering adding, let's say, steel stirrups there, like you might have done that in a concrete beam before. We don't need that. We've got way beyond what we need, like factor of 11. Longitudinal member analysis, how long is it? We've got our W values here. We wind up with our total load is 1,680 pounds per linear feet. My actual W prime value now, accounting for the two directional loads, top and bottom, would be 3.02 kips per linear feet. Our maximum moment check, this is now in the long axis. This is the 90 feet span. We get 6,119 foot kips. Now we've got to check for how much steel do we put in the 90 foot dimension span. So a number 8 bar cross-sectional area. Yeah, if we multiply it by 8 bars, we'd have 3.95 inches squared. I'm going to estimate D, the total depth of that inclined beam. It's 42.42 feet in length. That was lowercase b, right? I'm going to say the 0.42 feet is the cover. Now, why do I have such a large number? I'm not going to have one steel bar at the bottom of that inclined element to kick that load. I need more steel than one bar. So I'm going to assume I'm going to have a series of bars down there to pick up all that tension load. So I'm picking up the center of the system is going to be somewhere about 0.42 feet, assuming there's still going to be 1 inch at the bottom. So D is estimated, if I convert it to inches, to 168 inches. The row actual value that I have, ASBD with the 3.95 inches squared, divided that out, I get 0.006. Row minimum is 0.003, and row maximum would be 0.005 or 0.025. So the amount of steel that I projected and I put in is twice the minimum, but it's not hitting the maximum. So I can still consider that valid to keep going. I'm going to go for the final moment check. Now that I know how much steel is in there, I'm going to run through my moment check. It's the standard formula right here. Running it through, converting to kip feet. Here's my problem. My actual moment was 6,119, but my capacity with the system that I have now is 2,918. So roughly, I'm unsafe by about a factor of 2 in bending. So rather than change everything in the system, what's the thing that I can do? You agree that I have less steel than I need, right? I'm like twice the minimum, but I still have a lot of room to add more steel. Does that make sense? So the easiest thing to do, so the quick solution, is just push more steel in. Push more steel in and I increase the capacity and the strength and bending and leave everything else alone, okay? So I'm just gonna basically do a little bit more than double it. I'm gonna take my initial value here and put a little bit more on top of it. Roughly a little like 2.1 or something, 2.05. And I'm estimating if I run the numbers, I'll be safe. And yeah, I am. My capacity now goes to 6,401. I need anything roughly over 6,119. So I'm safe, but I don't have excess steel and capacity I don't need. Solving for the AS actual, and what would it look like? This piece on the end that's been tipped, it probably would look like this. You might say, well, why do we taper these? Well, the maximum bending moment's really going to be somewhere in here because it is simply supported on either end. So it's got a parabolic curve for maximum moment. So you're loading up more steel here and less steel here. Now you might say, well, why don't you just load it all up the same all the way through the end? The engineers would say, you know, steel costs money. We don't need to do that, because think about this. There may be 20 plates in this roof or 30 plates in this roof, depending how large the building is. So they're going to calculate sort of the taper point. So I calculated out here, AS actual, based on my numbers, I need 9.41 inches squared of slab length. So number 8 bar, 1 inches in diameter, 0.279 inches squared per cross-section area per bar. That means I need 12 bars total to hit my number. So I'm suggesting that I would have 2 rows of 6 down below. And if you remember, I said, I'm going to estimate my center point centroid of all the steel to be about 14 feet. And if I do the math, I should still have 1 inch of cover at the bottom, which is what I need. My 14 foot estimate was not a bad value to get started. And I can pack the steel in and get the cover that I need. The AS actual now changes to 9.48 inches squared for the system. Examples of folded plates and buildings. This is the Museum of Modern Art in Fort Worth, Texas by Tando Ando, Japan, 2001. It was patterned somewhat off of looking at the Kimball Museum, which is literally right very close to it, built by Louis Kahn. The roof system consists of long parallel strips, each of complex torsionally rigid folded plates of architectural concrete, from which lower roof strips are suspended. And so if to take a look at the cross section, that's where your folded plate sort of is hiding in this condition here. Columns at either end are picking it up. Here is sort of the construction or the erection sequence as these precast elements are put in place and put in their final form. And then at the gap between the folded plates is the skylight that lets the light into the museum. That's the basic strategy. Folded plates can come in different configurations. The one on the top is north light. In other words, the south is blocking the, not letting direct light in. The light reflects off the rear, the opposite side of the folded plate, and then can enter in through the vertical section of glass there that you would see that would probably be called a clear story. In this case, you just have a single opening coming through from the top. And in this case, there's a little suggested reinforcement for the folded plates. Remember we talked about diaphragms and folded plates, right? In this case, this steel bar is put to counteract those rotational forces that occur at the cantilever condition, because there is no connection point here. So literally these two pieces are cantilevered, because this would be a glass, let's say, skylight. A top light is kind of like this lazy S, as they would call it here, in this configuration, and glass on the other side. Examples of folded plates as three-dimensional structures. This is sort of like a portal frame in concrete. There are actual buildings like this, where you've got the sort of the Japanese folding concept of origami. How could you fold this element together out of sheet of paper? And that's where you see it on the upper left-hand side. Exhibition hall in Turin by Pier Luigi Nervi uses these folded plates combined with skylights in 1948. A project on the right wasn't built. It was from Illinois Institute of Technology in 1955, a student of Conrad Waxman. He wanted to do a sort of like a large auditorium, performance auditorium with steel and glass. Looked like this in the one axis, but in the short axis, this long span was created with a series of folded plates and then anchored by concrete. Kowloon Canton Railway Terminal. This is by Norman Foster, 1992-1997. This is not really I don't know if this is truly a rigid sort of folded plate system, but it is kind of like a spine with a series of ribs on it. Everybody see that? So there is some material across the top, which is part of the stiffening of it as well. But a lot of the weight is obviously going here. Does everybody follow me? There's not really a continuous ridge across the top like the folded plates I showed you. So basically it's this bottom piece, kind of like the spine of the sort of rib system that's going to be doing all the work. Another view of it. This is in India. This was a manufacturer, sorry, an industrial type plant facility. Large folded plates are in concrete. Why would you use concrete? Well, hot, humid, hot, arid climates. You know, concrete has the ability to absorb some of the excess heat inside the building and keep it cooler. Obviously, in some of these types of buildings, you would also see a vented operable skylight at the top, so warm air rises and the heat moves out. This is in Wayne, Michigan. It's a memorial hall from one of the schools. It is a folded plate in concrete. They're showing you how you pour it and create the formwork. You notice they start by pouring it at the bottom and they work their way up. But you know why? Why does that make sense? Concrete's kind of liquid when you pour it out, right? Does that make sense? So if you start on the bottom, it hardens. You can move progressively up. It's not going to flow, right? You've got something stopping the flow. And so here's what it's like after they pull off the formwork on the interior. Steel reinforcing was there on the right. This is an interesting building. It's actually in Detroit. I think it's in Troy. This is Minoru Yamasaki. This was the headquarters for the American Concrete Institute. They wanted to create an interesting building that showed the potential of concrete. So the sort of center hall here is supporting these big cantilevered folded plates that come off. And it's a rigid joint here. Here's how the folded plates, again, kind of an origami shape formed. You can probably visit this today. This is a large, it's an airport lobby area in Sweden, part of the Grand Terminal. This is what you would see if you looked at it from above. And there you could see steel folded plates are there for the glass and the glazing in the system. This is Raphael Vannoli, 1998. This is a performing arts center in Philadelphia. This is an enormous cylindrical vault, circular vault, but it's made of folded plate steel sections with glass across the roof. FKB Airport, Cologne, Germany, by Murphy Jahn, 97 to 2003. They built portions of this roof on the ground. Remember we talked about that for space frames? You build a portion and you lift it up. So they built a portion of these steel folded plates on the ground. Then the cranes would lift them up and put them in place. They had PV panels for energy on the south side, but then they're glazed on the north side to let in daylight. This is what it looks like. The columns, there's a series of these singular columns. They have enormous brackets here. And the big bracket conditions do have redundancy. So there was a concern that if one of the columns failed, would the other columns be able to hold up the roof? And the answer was yes, with the big bracket arms, there's a redundancy in the system. Even though we have very few columns, one column can pick up not just only its own weight, but part of the adjoining two column weights as well. Some of you might know this, Yokohama Port Authority. This is by Foreign Office Architects, 2002. Literally, when you see it from the top along this water's edge, you would think it's kind of like a park that you would be walking on, right, with the grass there and the decking. But actually, it's a part of a folded plate concrete system down below that forms the structure and supports the earth up above. And there we are, a view of it. There we are. Nursery, child care in Japan, 2012. In this case, folded plates, but out of timber, trussing timber elements. So in this case, the folded plate does show you that it is a truss. You can see the diagonal elements in there to pick up some shear forces. Obviously, Japan's high earthquake. So you see a lot of bracing here in the sort of paired column conditions because they've got to pick up those larger earthquake loads. Zaha Hadid, this is the Riverside Museum Transport, 2007-2011. So the building is close to a bend in the river, and so literally the building shape and form kind of reflects the bend in the river, and then folded plates are used in steel to sort of create that undulated roof that you see on the upper left and the lower right. You're seeing the structure plan here in red, showing the framework. This is a museum in Germany, I think. It's Corten steel plate, and it's a rusting sort of steel plate that would age over time. again, kind of like origami configurations. You can imagine it is kind of thought about as being sort of a continuous sheet, but I'm sure these panels are welded to create the continuity. But it's a column-free museum space that you see. Parametric modeling, you can use Grasshopper. There is a folded plate capability with scripting that you could create folded plate structures. And you can see on the left-hand side, there's a couple links. I'll show you how it's done. This was a student project that used this Grasshopper script to create a folded plate for this aquarium on the right-hand side. Some studies done by a Korean University Graduate School of Architecture. They're creating these folded plate. As you can see, all the iterations here, there's 15 of them. Sorry, 15 various versions of them. They're checking some of the stress and force conditions across here, and they're seeing how they behave and looking for some optimization in terms of performance. This is kind of interesting. It was a temporary shelter. It was made of corrugated cardboard. Basically, you know, these pieces could be dropped in, folded up, and put together, but then unpacked, and they would create sort of like a half vault and corrugated cardboard to create a shelter during an emergency. All right, homework. I want you to do one of the both these two folded plate roofs. They're basically the same as the example problems. So go ahead and take a look at them. They're on your Canvas website. You should have the information that you need. One is steel up above, and the second one is concrete down below. All right, as I said, the last lecture here that we'll take a look at today is cylindrical vaults. And so this is kind of a different version of a folded plate in the sense that there's two force direction conditions here. There's a transverse and a longitudinal, but we don't have rectilinear geometries anymore. We have curvilinear geometries. So we'll take an overlook, we'll do a little review of these barrel vault type systems, cylindrical vault type systems. We'll take a look at them in concrete. We'll take a look at them as a solid concrete piece to evaluate. Then we'll look at braced frames that could be wood, they could be steel, that are created out of bracing elements, sort of like space frames are. We'll do an approximate analysis of their vaults, some case examples, and some homework. On the left-hand side, cylindrical vault by Pier Luigi Nervi. It's a airport hangar, 1950 on the left-hand side. And then on the right-hand side, it's kind of like a waffle slab, if you will, though, is the formwork underneath. On the right-hand side was what's called an expandable surface pavilion. This is made out of plywood sheets, and there are a series of what are called kerf cuts into the plywood that allow it to be bent or curved like that to create that shape. This was kind of like what you call a build lab, or what they used to call make lab here, student project. They were experimenting on how they could make these shapes and forms. This would not be something exterior use. This was designed sort of an interior demonstration project. Barrel vaults, early examples of these systems were typically one-way acting, right? In other words, we have a series of bricks or stones. They run in this direction. They only have single span condition. And then they're just attached linearly. So these are one-way acting systems. But as shapes started to change and materials changed, in this case, you now have a longitudinally supported two-way acting system with a space frame. This is in Japan. It's kind of like an outdoor shopping mall where they have this enormous canopy cover to keep the rain and sun out. And it's supported by the columns. You can see some of the columns here on either end. So concrete shells were one of the earlier examples of these types of systems. They were cast in place, monolithic. And so therefore, one of the advantages of them would be you don't really have perforations. Perforations in the roofs are joints in the roof because it's one continuous pour. You've got a high degree of continuity of surface. Why is that important? You want to keep the water out. And one of the problems with folded plates, as you could see, and you still see it with cylindrical vaults, you have a valley, right? And you can be, you know, can be ponding water and snow in the valley. So often you would see the folded plates or cylindrical vaults be in climates where you don't have snow. Now, I know I showed you the project in Sweden, but that's part of the exception to it. But in many cases, these were probably built more often in areas where there's no snow, more temperate climates or hot climates. So these systems are shown here. Here's the generator. In this case, it's a semicircle. These also can have ribbing supports at some intervals, and this adds stiffness to the system. Typically, the ribbing might be at some dimension, 20, 30, 40 feet, depending on the span. And the rib is linked back but to a column. Cylindrical shells may be classified as long if the radius of curvature is shorter than the span or as short. So a barrel vault would be an early form of shell architecture as an example. Typically with barrel vaults, you'll also have an edge beam along the perimeter edges, help pick up some of the stresses and forces. So what would be the three types of characteristic profiles or geometries that you could see? Well, on the left-hand side, that would be a short vault. In other words, you've got a bunch of support conditions here and you've got loads going in this direction, and that's the principal span. Now, if I take away these intermediate supports and I put columns on either end, then possibly I'm starting to move into a longer span condition. If I had four support conditions on this axis as well as this axis, this would be classified as a two-way acting shell vault, meaning forces are going in two directions. But this one, where I've got a short dimension here and a reasonably long dimension in this case, with only four columns at the end, I am going to have to transfer forces this way across the system, but the principal span condition is this one. So this is a true one-way acting cylindrical vault that is basically a beam. So when L, principal span divided by R, that's the radius that describes it, is less than 2, you have arch behavior. But when L over R is greater than 2, then you have one-way acting beam behavior, similar to folded plates. So forms of curvature, these are sometimes called developable surfaces. That means they're a single axis curvature. A developable surface means if you were to make this out of a single sheet, let's say of paper, you could make it out of a single sheet of paper. You would not have to have more complex of surface materials to develop than that. The principal lines of stresses would look something like this. Principal in compression here in solid lines, principal in tension here. So principal meaning they're axial, compression and tension. Now, why are you seeing some concentration points here and here? Well, that's the mid-span. Let's say that's uniformly loaded. You're going to be seeing like compression concentrations of forces and stresses here. And you're going to be seeing tension. That's the dotted line force concentrations at mid-span. Now, notice what happens when you get to the end, right? They dissipate. You notice you don't have a lot of intensity of stress, principal stress lines here. That's basically telling you there's not going to be a lot of force and stress there. So types of shell structures could look something like this: corrugated, unstiffened edges, multiple barrels with an outside. This is called an upstand beam. That's a stiffener of the shape at the end. Now, why do we have it at the end? Same reason a folded plate has a diaphragm at the end support condition. You're going to have shear forces there that could flatten the curvature of the vault. So you have some stiffening here. This is literally a beam above the vault. And you could have what's called an S shape as well. So constructions of reinforced concrete vaults could look something like this. In some cases, they're introducing top lighting these systems because they're like a series of them. And so you would have what are called sort of the stabilizing ribs here. This is the print. And so now you've got part of the vault spanning in this direction and part of the vault going in this direction. But a true two-way acting vault or one-way acting system is this one. We don't have the little column spaces here. We've got a long span condition here, very few columns underneath. and we've got one-way action force going on here. The width is about half the span. The span rise is about 1/5 of the width relative to height and depth. So this would be an upstand arch rib. This would be the folded plate, or sorry, the cylindrical vault concrete here. This is a stiffening rib above it. A rib could be below it. This is the downstand rib. And sometimes we talked about what happens at the end supports of an arch. Remember, lateral thrust pushes the arch outward. And in this case, you've got a tie rod to keep the lateral thrust in check from the outward thrust. Now, the shapes of the concrete might look something like this for continuous pours, meaning there's some extra thickness here and extra thickness here in some cases because you're adding some stiffness through these sort of beam elements in the system. Expansion joints might be needed in some cases based on length. You've got expansion contraction conditions to account for. And so there's some, in some instances, you have to joint them. When you have an expansion joint, it means you're physically separating the structure into two pieces. And notice there's two columns here, one on the left side of the joint, one on the right side of the joint. They're basically two independent pieces. All right, advantage and disadvantages. Advantages, light form of construction can span up to 30 meters, roughly 90 feet. Dead load can be reduced by choosing the right shape and profile. They take advantage of the fact that arch shapes can span longer. Some disadvantages are shuttering problems, meaning the element could be too thin in some areas relative to the forces acting on them. These are like space frames. You like uniform loads and not concentrated loads. You need to have proper supervision of labor in the construction process. The rise of the roof could be a disadvantage because in some cases, like we talked about, you might have snow or ponding conditions generated from snow in steeply pitched areas. So construction of reinforced concrete vault, you could have roof lights or top lighting conditions involved in them. Roof coverings could be non-ferrous sheet metals like standing seam, or they could be single ply rubberized sheet elements as well, liquid rubber. Roof insulation generally above it, not below. Roof insulation on the top is sometimes referred to as an upside down roof, if you will. Or an inverted roof. It's a better form, a better technique for providing insulation. And then on the inside, you don't have to have finished material because the concrete is generally considered to be acceptable as a finished material in the interior. Some studies of just the concrete fold condition or the shape conditions. Again, some beam action going on here. This is at the vertices between two elements. So kind of like a folded plate, you know, you kind of have a long support condition here. So you've got some deepness here of the fold of the cylindrical vault to provide some beam action. The computer model I made of a semicircular concrete cylindrical vault up above. The load conditions are all uniform, acting perpendicular to the surface. And what you would see something like this, compression is blue, tension is red. So on the bottom, you've got the tension going on at the mid span. At the top, you've got the blue coming in at the mid-span because that's where the moment forces are largest. And then you've got these bright green regions, which is, again, kind of like suggesting this the lack of principal stress conditions, meaning you don't need much material there. There's not much force there. Now, the darker greens coming in at the ends because shear forces are starting to take over, and those shear forces are starting to create stress conditions. Form generation. You could have what's called a conoid. These elements are called the directrix. They're the edge condition on either end. The genericity is developing its shape in the long axis. So curved on one end, flat on the other. Pure cylindrical vault, both sides the same, or maybe even two slanted line segments as a hyperbolic paraboloid. Those are all possible. All right, so when we talk about some of these curvilinear elements here, they're all based generally on what's called membrane theory. So membrane theory and stresses are somewhat illustrated here, but not in an arch, but sort of like an upside down arch, if you will. And so if you take a look here, kind of imagine this is kind of like a cable but structure, but it's really made of a solid element. At the center point, somewhere here, you've got a piece of that section of that piece that you're taking out. And it's sagging downwards, so you know you're going to have a tension force here and a tension force there. And you're going to have some equilibrium being satisfied. In other words, the total weight, capital W acting down over that segment, that's W delta L because the width is delta L, has to be equal to the force opposite of it, which is sine T there on the right and the left, and two times that value because you have to have this and this to counteract the total weight in the center. So the forces you're seeing here for T for that pure angular reaction is taken as this value. The tension is proportional to the radius. So in changes in radius, we have changes in our tension values. So membrane structures typically have these sorts of stress conditions. You might have tension and shear forces along the membrane as a result of the load conditions and support conditions. So you've got multiple stresses acting here, tension, compression, and shear. Transverse axial, that's my TX and TY. Longitudinal TX, rather, transverse TY. And shear forces, typically shear forces are going to be most evident at the supports. So let's take a look at some formulas to basically evaluate them like we did for the folded plate. So this is a concrete cylindrical vault. It's 25 feet in width. It's the lowercase b. Its height is only five feet. That's H on the right. Snow load is 30 PSF. The dead load is 30 PSF. 33 PSF. The shell thickness is 3 inches. Shell is made of concrete. 3,000. You have to have, for these systems, you have to have more than 3,000 PSI for the concrete strength. So ours is 4,000. And we've got 60 KSI for FY for the steel strength. Our height to width span ratio, H over L, 5 over 80, 1 to 15. It's okay. It's sufficient depth for a relative span. Here's some of our basic geometries, as we'll be seeing them in a minute. Our generating radius, what's the generating radius, the R value that creates this shape? Well, you have R squared, capital R squared for radius is equal to B over 2 squared plus R minus H, where H is our height. B is our horizontal width. So if you plug the numbers in, calculate this, you'll eventually find out R is going to be 18.125 feet. So here's the 18.125 feet. Does that make sense? That's our generating radius condition. The maximum shell slope along either edge is computed as follows. Tangent of 12.5 divided by the 18.125 minus 5. That 5 is the height. 12.5 is our width condition. So we're calculating our angle at 43.6 degrees. That's this angle right here. Measured from the vertice, the center point of that cylindrical vault, counterclockwise, that's the support point, and that's the support point on either side. That gives us the 5 feet that we need plus the span width B that we were looking for. We calculate the values cosine and sine, and value is in radians as well for the angle, not just in degrees, because we'll need those values. The buckling of the shell would occur with respect to the longitudinal beam. That's the principal span. The compressive stress are maximum at the crown, at the very midspan point. It's advisable to maintain a radius to thickness ratio, R capital R over T, less than 200. So we have 18.125 for the R value times 12 inches, because we're in inches here, divided by 3. So we have 72.5, and so we're less than 200, so we should have sufficient thickness. The span to radius ratio should be greater than 2. We are at 4.4. That's 80 divided by the 18.125. So anything larger than 2 is okay. It's going to act like a beam in the long axis. What is the actual arc length of the shell? And remember, why do we need to know that? Because our dead loads are always described along the geometry. So horizontal dimensions not going to be used for dead load weight, so to speak. So we have pi times r angled 0 over 90. plugging our values in, we get 27.61 feet. So that's our actual length of this element here. Remember we said, we said our shell width is 25 feet. That's our lowercase b. You would expect that your calculation has to be larger than 25, right? Curvilinear line segment has to be more than 25. So that's your sort of basic math check. But it's a fairly shallow arch. So the next part is the location of the neutral axis. When you saw that diagram I showed you, there's sort of like bending stress going through the system at the top. And the measure, the location of the bending axis, the neutral axis from the center point right here is measured as an angular measure. And so this value C sub T is R times one minus sine at zero over the radian at zero. Calculating the value, it's 1.69 feet down from the top. That means our bending stress goes to zero there, and it peaks at compression here, and it peaks at tension on the bottom. So from the bottom side, we have 5 feet minus 1.69, so its neutral axis 3.31 feet from the bottom. Cosine of my neutral angle is shown here for math calculation reasons, and sine values here. Statical moment of area about the centroidal axis is shown here, 4.51 feet cubed. But more important value is moment of inertia. So this is a complex problem. So this is our moment of inertia of that cross-sectional shape. Please watch your brackets. Everybody follow me. You would start with inner brackets first, and you would move to the outer brackets at the very end, and then finally you do the last step in calculation. So start with inner brackets moving to outside. So all the sine and radian values and cosine values we had to calculate earlier, and I'll now put the work. This is all plugged into our equation. We should be in unit consistency, so we should be fine in feet here, and we wind up with our value in feet. And I know feet to the fourth for moment of inertia is not normal. We're normally in inches, but we're just leaving values here in feet for simplifying the calculation. And my total load is shown here because it's concrete. Live load and dead load modifiers are shown here, the 1.4, the 1.7. And remember my dead load, 26.61 feet. That's my dead load on the left, my live load here. Running our numbers through, and we're converting this to kips per linear feet. We're at 2.55 kips per linear feet for load. Our maximum moment, WUL squared over 8, 2040 foot kips. The maximum bending stress at the compression of the crown would be M sub U times CT over I, MC over I. That's why I needed to know the neutral axis location. Now I'm going to do my unit conversion. This is how I'm going to get from feet to the fourth. Back to KSI in inches. So I get my FU at 1.07 KSI. My F sub C allowable is a safety factor at 0.7.85 times F prime C. I get 2.38 KSI, and I'm safe because my capacity roughly twice as much as the actual. The maximum tensile strength, again, will be at the midspan, but it'll be at the bottom. In this case, I need C sub B, MC over I is on the bottom. I get 2.1 KSI. Examining the stress distribution of the height at 1 foot from the base, tensile capacity, I get 75.6 kips per inch for tension capacity I need. Now, how much steel is that? Well, I take my maximum value divided by 0.9 as a safety factor. My Fy is 75.6 kip inches times 0.9 is a safety factor times KSI, the steel strength capacity. I need 1.4 inches squared per foot of steel at the bottom edge to provide the steel stiffness. Number five bars, the area for number five bars is 0.307, and I'd be spacing with 2.5 inches on center. So roughly I'd have 1.47 inches squared per foot for those steel bars, and I only needed 1.4, so I would be exceeding what I need. I'm okay, I have enough steel. Examples of these, this is Eladio Diest from South America, and known for his work with, is a Uruguayan engineer known for his work with innovative construction methods for these sort of cylindrical vault, or what we call Gaussian vault, double arch geometries. These were largely made of brick or masonry units, not necessarily concrete. They had to have formwork, of course, to be built. Brace frame barrel vault systems, another possibility. Could you make these out of, generally they're made out of space frame type systems, if you will. And so here's a space frame double layer vault. That's kind of similar to that Japanese pavilion that I showed you at the very beginning. So it's a double layer barrel vault, enhances the stiffness of the structure. You could have capable systems exceeding, you said 100 meters here, so you're up to like 300 feet for something like this. That's quite large. The vault shape obviously starts to reduce some of the force concentrations and stress concentrations. These would be examples of these. So a single layer grid on the upper left, a diagonal lamella grid. You could have a three-way barrel vault with ribbing, upper and lower grid condition that you would have here, like a space frame. And you could have a two-way acting truss. So you've got two trusses at intersections here. They don't have to be cylindrical vaults. They could be other shapes and forms, as you would see here and here, where they've got maybe compound curvature going on. It's not just curving in one axis, but it's curving in both. Parametric modeling allows these to be made today, fabricated, but also allows them to be analyzed because geometry can be determined and defined. These are framed vaults. These are typically made of steel elements, again, sort of like space frame configurations, often single layer, but not double layer. So let's take a look at an evaluation of one of these. So at the upper right-hand sign, you're seeing a lamella vault here, and you see the diagonal sort of net, like a mesh net configuration of rhomboids or the triangle, these sort of diamond shapes that make up these elements, these frameworks here. Lamella roofs are composed of skewed rib grids with approximate 20 degree to 40 degree angles between them. This is the 20 and 20 here. The ribs are made of members about twice the length of the lodge and with C. So these elements, whatever that dimension is here, these elements would probably be at least twice that long. Each rib taking thrust and bending moment. So they've got to pick up bending conditions, but also because they're in compression, they're picking up a thrust force as well. Continuous ribs would be shown here as A and B. A joined rib would be C and D, meaning this is one point connection from here to here, a single member. This is only a short member from here to here connecting into a longer member. So there's some continuity. You like continuity to add stiffness. So some of the elements are basically twice as long as the others. The thrust force is resisted by the effective cross-sectional area cut, as you would say here. And that value, A prime, is 2A divided by cosine alpha, where alpha is my angle measurement here. My section modulus would be S over cosine alpha as well, or S prime is 2S cosine alpha. Factor 2 is used because both members resist bending forces. The total force condition, using the interaction formula, we used this before for arches, says that compression force divided by the cross-sectional area over which it acts, that's the the actual lowercase fc, divided by the allowable compressive stress, capital FC, add that ratio together to the bending stress actual over the bending stress allowable. We've seen the arguments for these before. Together, those two stress conditions have to be less than one. Otherwise, we have failure. We have overloading condition and compression, just like arches. The maximum moment would occur at about 1/6 and 1/4 of the span from the support along its length. So calculation procedures are shown here. You're seeing a lateral thrust reaction on the left-hand side. You're seeing a vertical reaction at the top, or over here for R1 is my vertical reaction, my lateral thrust H. This lateral thrust force here is in equilibrium with the lateral force here. Your H2 and your H1 would be here and here on equal portions of this. You have R1 for my reaction here, and usually if it's symmetrical, it would be reactive symmetrical. But remember when we talked about wind, snow blowing off one side of the roof and depositing itself on the other? That's what you're seeing here. This is my dead load. This is my live load. So the assumption is wind was coming in this direction. Clean off effect takes off the snow. It dumps it on the other side. So 1/2 of the load of live loads is going to the right-hand side. And hence, we're getting some different reaction values on the right-hand side than what we would have on the left. And our maximum moment, breaking down our values here for maximum moment are shown as W L squared over 64. Our compression force is broken down here. Is our maximum compression force going through the system. And our section modulus for cross-sectional ribs, BH squared over 6. So looking at all, putting this together in a calculation, here's our vault. It's got a parabolic profile. Span is 100 feet. Height is 1/4 of the span, or 25 feet. The internal angle that makes up these lozenge-shaped panel members is 20 degrees and 20 degrees. The members are made of wood beams, are 3 inches by 12 inches. And C, for the distance apart from vertice to vertice horizontally, is 4 feet. There's a dead load of 20 PSF, self-weight of all the system's components, and snow load is 40 PSF. C is 4 feet, alpha is 20 degrees, my capital W, plugging in our values here, W prime, 64 pounds per foot, and W prime over W is 0.8. Cosine alpha is 0.94, H is 3 inches, B is 3 inches, H is 12 inches, A is 36 inches squared per piece of wood, and S is 72 inches, inches cubed for the section modulus. My A prime value is 76.7 square inches. It's just a coincidence that S prime is also 76.7, but notice it's inches cubed. My maximum moment with live and dead loads plugging in, 120,000 pound inches, and my compression force plugging in all my values here, 6,261 pounds. This is timber, so F sub C in compression, 1450, is probably glue lam. FB at 1750 is bending. And plugging in my values for compression and bending, I have the 6261 over the 76.7 over the 1450. And for the bending side, maximum moment, section modulus, and F sub B allowable, 0.056, 0.89. My total stress then is 0.95. I'm safe and I only have a 5% margin. What is contributing most of the stress here? Is it bending or is it compression? It's obvious. What is it? It's bending, right? This right-hand side ratio is the bending. It's 89%. I'm only getting 5.5% out of the compression side. So this system, if you were going to improve it, would you create more cross-sectional area in the rib, or would you increase the depth of the rib? What would your answer be? Because that might come out on a test. You never know. If it's dominated by bending, would you increase the depth of that member? You'd increase the depth, right? You need a higher moment of inertia. Does that make sense? If it was dominated by compression, you'd want more cross-sectional area, right? So you don't need to increase the width. You need to increase the depth. A grandstand canopy by Edouard Torota, architect interested very much in his experiments and work with concrete, in this case, cylindrical vaults. So this is a very deep curvature condition here. This is a huge cantilever coming up on this side, but it gets shallower in depth here. Why? Well, that's a large moment force here, zero moment on this end, so you don't need that much depth there. So that's the flattening of that curvature. So this element does curve in two axes. It curves in this direction, but it also curves in the other direction. Felix Candela, I mentioned earlier, originally from Spain, settled in South America, is famous for his work in thin shell concrete vaults. This is a restaurant in Mexico. And you can see here, very thin. I think this was like 7/8 of an inch or 1 inch in thickness. It's called the flower. That was a pattern that was inspiring here. But remember, Mexico doesn't have snow, right? Does that make sense? So it is draining downward. So you don't pile water up in the interior region. You let the water roll down. So probably a building like this did not have, may have had minimal insulation, if at all. you know, being in that part of the country at the time. There was no air conditioning, so a tall space like this would let warm air rise up above the occupants, so it helps to keep it cool. Also, because concrete will absorb the radiant energy on the interior, it can reduce some of the temperatures on the interior. This was the one expandable pavilion that I showed you earlier. This is sort of a experimental student project using plywood to create these kind of kerf cut conditions to create the vault. Anybody probably heard of Lewis Kahn Kimball Museum? The shallow cycloid vaults that are shown in cross section across the top. And these, what are referred to as marginal beams, these house the HVAC. So you notice they're not very deep, but they're wide. The reason they're wide is because you have lateral thrust coming off of the cycloid pushing outward. So these elements are literally wide because they have to pick up that lateral thrust. That's why they're not deep. HVAC systems, mechanicals hidden underneath. And then there's a baffle here, so the light shines and reflects up. It's a cellular repeatable module. So you have the system constantly repeating. Hallway, exhibit space, or a large space, as the case may be, for the larger vault. Initial sketches by Lewis Kahn, view of the exterior, view of the interior of the vaults. Harry Weiss, I worked for Harry Weiss when I was a grad student in Chicago. This was the Washington, D.C. Metro in 1967. So when you have to excavate the earth, you know, to provide a tunnel, what kind of device do you use? Anybody know? Come on, nobody watches Build It Bigger on the DIY channel or whatever. No. You use an enormous boring tool, right? It bores through the earth. It creates the huge, you know, sort of circular hole, right? So basically the idea is pretty clear. You know, he knows he's going to have that sort of constant boring element creating that profile. And so basically this waffle slab and concrete sort of just fills in behind it and forms, if you will, kind of like the shuttering, the formwork and shape to maintain that profile, but also now to carry the loads of the earth up above. So he doesn't fight the fact that the construction condition creates that shape. He just reinforces it with the concrete in the vault. Hong Kong International Airport. Norman Foster, architect sketches here. These are these shallow cylindrical vaults here, here, and here. I think they're in steel. And I kept wondering, well, why do you keep doing them? Why do you keep shaving them in this direction when they get this thin? Why didn't you turn them at an angle, right, and make them go this way? But there's an answer to that. I guess the architect's answer is the direction of the vaults remains constant, regardless of the divergent directions that the prongs take. So the roof is an aid to orientation. I guess you always know where the water side is, because it's always at the end of the vaults, so to speak. The view of the interior, it's a lightweight sort of space frame system. I see the tubes, the columns are coming up, but then they have sort of like these sort of box truss pieces picking up the nodes of the space frame that make up the roof. Norman Foster was interested in what he called the clean ceiling effect for his airports, meaning he didn't want HVAC up here, he didn't want lighting up here, wanted to keep that fairly minimal. Now, this is a project that actually shows you why the shape is responsive to loads. This is the Frankfurt Messenhall by Nicholas Grimshaw. Grimshaw's a British architect. He had a quote once. He said, all architecture must have good bones, meaning you have to have a viable structural solution in your projects. It's basically like, I think it's like an exchange hall here. But here's the profile of it. And so I believe it's in steel. And you can see it's a cylindrical vault, but it flattens on this end. It rises to the maximum height here. And then there's glass here, but this portion is solid. And I created a model of my cylindrical vault that I showed you earlier. And notice what I'm seeing, right? I'm seeing this shear force going on here. That's the darker green, right? The bright green means minimal stresses, right? So what does minimal stress mean? I don't need material there. Everybody follow me? I don't have to have steel or concrete there. I don't have much stress there. But I'm peaking here with compression stress at the top. And that's because the maximum moment's there. And so look at what's going on. my shear stresses are concentrating here. You see that in the profile of stress. So I'm also flattening the arch at this point because I don't have big bending stresses there, but I have big bending stresses at the top, midspan. So I make it deeper to increase its moment of inertia, reducing the stress. But then, and these sides here, I have the really low stress region. So the architect says, well, that's where I'm going to cut in the glass, right? I'm going to let in my natural light at that portion because I don't need the mass of the material to reduce, to pick up stress conditions. Here are some of the actual stress models across the top, the bending stress, shear stress, axial compression, tension up above that were generated. There's a diagram rendering of the interior. Now, kind of, because it's an arch in this direction, it's got lateral thrust, right? So notice we've got the X bracing here for the supports on the end. That's to pick up the lateral thrust condition. And you see a very elegant structure where literally, if you understand how forces and stresses work, you understand the shape, you understand the supports, you understand where more material is needed and where it can be taken away. And I think that's the, you know, architects that work with structures and their work is highlighted by intelligent use of structures, understand that. Now, this is also Norman Foster. This was in Mexico. It was not built. It was like a telecommunications headquarters, 1986, but it is a shallow cylindrical concrete vault. Here you see the model of it here. And here's a sort of the 3D model rendering of it. So scalloped concretes like ribs that were introduced here, and like a waffle slab in order to create more stiffness. The center portion gets removed, and that's your daylighting condition across the top. There's a baffle, so direct sun doesn't come in. Again, Mexico, hot, humid place. Warm air rises up. Concrete absorbs some of the excess energy here, keeping occupants cooler. And the ribs are actually picking up some lateral thrust here. And notice these sort of tie rods across the top, because this is a fairly large slot there through the center. This is World Birding Center by Lake Flato Architects out of Texas. And this is basically what you probably would have known as a military Quonset hut, enormous corrugated metal roof conditions. They developed this because it was an agricultural area, so they thought Quonset huts and things like these storage bin elements, which in this case is a cistern for rainwater collection, could be used there. It's part of what you see in the landscape. But there's also an interesting thing. There's a practicality behind this system as well. I think that's looking for the value here. Oh, yeah. If you compared the roof condition here to a traditional truss and deck steel deck system, this system reduces the amount of steel required by 48%. So using about half the percent amount of steel you would have used if you had more steel, a conventional steel truss system. This is Norman Foster. This is the University of Cambridge Law School. This is basically a two-way acting truss, somewhat like a grid frame, if you will, in steel. And it's sort of rotated and tipped on its side. And that's what it looks like. So it's supported on this side. And this is a detail. The intent was the panels of the glass panels that make up the top are mirror imaging the form of the truss below. And because it's a truss, how do they load the truss? They load it at a node point and they load it with a single concentrated load. So they're minimizing the bending in the truss piece. This is Miro again, the space frame company, but these are cylindrical vaults. Frank Gehry on the right-hand side, another project, German project on the left-hand side, these large atria structures, lightweight. They're probably aluminum. I don't think they're steel. Covering for a Roman antiquities excavation site in Germany. Julius Natterer, Swiss engineer, creating these out of timber. This is a gallery container of a replication of replicating a boat, sort of a vernacular boat or ship, so to speak. And this was the configuration with these wood slat vaults, sort of a lamella grid pattern to create the framework for the roof. This is a sports hall in Berlin. You see the cross section up above, but again, a thin lamella vault with wood decking across the top. This is in the United States. This is the Rural Studio from Auburn University. This was a, animal shelter. And this is largely recycled wood and lumber. And they use these sort of diagonal grid lamella grid sections and timber to put this together with some recycled roofing sheet metal across the top, polycarbonate plastic here. So they create this enormous shelter. This is kind of like you call a dog run or something. This is where the animals would go out, but they have to stay out of the heat because of the temperature and the climate. So a couple of equations here. I'd like you to take a look at concrete vault number one. Use the example to calculate it. And the lamella vault from the example that I gave you, I'm going to ask you to work with just changing a couple dimensions. The question I'm going to ask you is, what change would it produce in values? In other words, are you seeing more stress or less stress in compression or bending by making changes in these two values relative to the demonstration case example? And so that's it. I'm at about 7:16, so I know I've got one group wants to talk to me, so I'll stop here. So you've got some homework, your space frames, just a couple problems there, and a couple problems from the cylindrical vaults here.